This reader in German at Aberystwyth, she is about to achieve huge prominence in connection with her important work on the Kinder transport, and she is constantly being also, she's going to be one of our media dons and so forth. We also heard her important words on exactly the theme of this conference with the previous conference that she organised, called Alone, the previous book that came out of that. And she is going to talk about the novels of A and B.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you for the introduction. I don't think I should have given anything away. In the conclusion of Jüdin und Moderne, Gundula by Sussex comes back to the aim of her project, der Geschichte des Vergessens der Aussparung entgegenzuwirken. In the film of women's exile writing, this is an important aim and one that was the focus of research for many years. Both novelists I will discuss today had been forgotten and had to be rediscovered. But a simple rediscovery is not enough. It is also important to focus on how to discuss the writers and their works, how to discuss their identity as women and Jewish, and how to locate them in the discussion surrounding modernity, as the period after 1933 is often, obviously, seen as a fracture in the modern project. I will focus today on two writers who fled Austria, so, and Germany, and spent their exile in Britain. I will focus on Martina Wied's novel Das Crane Nest, The Crow's Nest, and Anna Gmeyner's novel Café du Dom. Now, Wied was born on 10th December 1982 in Vienna. Her mother was Jenny Schnabel, Jewish and a poet. Her father was Dr. Josef Schnabel, who converted to Judaism upon his marriage to her mother and worked as a lawyer for the finance ministry in Vienna. Wied, and I quote, converted to Catholicism in her 20s and became a devout member of the church, unquote. This background left her with a double Judeo-Catholic heritage, which I think is reflected in her work. Literary culture and education were encouraged in her family, and she wrote poetry even as a schoolgirl, gained the Reifeprüfung at the Vienna Lyceum, and started studying modern philology, philosophy, history, and history of art at the University of Vienna. She left the university in 1910 in order to marry the company director, Dr. Siegfried Weiser, and on the 11th of March 1911, their only son, Georg, was born. Now, Wied worked as a journalist and as a writer, and like fellow exile writer Hilde Spiel, she also felt tension between this desire to be a creative writer and the need to earn a living, especially in these economically difficult post-First World War times and also after her husband's death. Her early career is especially associated with Der Brenner, but she contributed to a variety of newspapers and journals such as the Neue Freie Presse, Wiener Tagblatt, Wiener Zeitung, Deutsche Allgemeine Zeitung und Vossische Zeitung. Wied was a successful writer, although her novels were first and foremost published in serialized form in newspapers. And this publishing outlet, of course, ceased to exist for Wied in exile. And her novels, written and finished in Britain, were all published in Austria after 1947. Now, Wied prepared to leave Austria after the Anschluss, but a long illness and the fact that she decided to wait until her son had left for Bolivia delayed her flight, and she finally arrived in Britain on the 9th of March 1939. Initially, she stayed with some acquaintances, then in a hostel attached to a convent in Glasgow, and she did continue to write throughout. According to her autobiographical notes, she left Scotland for England on the 25th of April 1943, finding employment as a teacher in various private schools in England and Wales. Although she complained that her work as a teacher was hampering her literary production, she managed to finish the 600-page novel Das Gmeyner between 1944 and 1945. She did, as I said, not publish her works, and they were all written in German during the war. Now, all her novels were published between 47 and 54 in Vienna after Wied's return to Austria. That return happened on the 15th of September 1947. Wied therefore appears to have been relatively successful in re-establishing her literary career after her re-migration, I suppose, or return. That would be an interesting thing to discuss, after she moved to Vienna. Now, this view is supported by the fact that she was the first woman writer who received the Österreichische Staatspreis für Literatur in 1952. Whereas other exile novels such as Alan Gmeyner's Mania were literally forgotten for nearly 15 years, Wied's brief but official prominence seemed to have initiated a different approach to her work. Brief analysis of Das Gmeyner can, for example, be found in overviews such as Werner Belzig's Der deutsche Roman im 20. Jahrhundert and Roland Heger's Der österreichische Roman im 20. Jahrhundert. While an overemphasis on the biographical aspects of exile can be found in the critical reception of some works by exile writers, some resumes of Wied's exile novels neglect to mention significant biographical facts such as her flight to Britain. Roland Heger describes the circumstances surrounding the sequence in which Wied's exile novels were published as biographische Zufälle, biographical coincidences. Werner Belzig mentions in his entry that Wied wrote Das Gmeyner in England, it's not entirely true, she finished it in Wales, but does not give any details of the circumstances of the move from Austria to Britain. This could one led to believe that being an exile writer might disqualify a writer somehow from prominence, and this is why it is not mentioned. So this discussion surrounding the quality of literature is one that hampered the early years of research into exile writing, and I think it has not been entirely overcome. According to Alexander Stefan, the reality of exile was a source for most refugee writers' works. Nahezu alle Exilanten haben die Erfahrung des Exils auf die eine oder andere Weise in ihren Werken verarbeitet. While this is on the one hand a rather obvious statement, but it becomes problematic when this is all we are ever looking at in exile writers' work. Wied herself saw the motif of the homeless intellectual as a general theme for her whole work rather than merely as a social historical background. Elisabeth Bonfen discusses this tension of exile as a metaphor and precondition for modern art, and exile as a brutal reality of visas and boarding houses. And this discussion is relevant to a number of writers such as Wied, this tension. Now, Wied's employment as a school teacher during her exile years in Britain had an impact on the choice of settings in Das Gmeyner, but Wied warns of a too literal identification of herself with the main character, Madeleine. Zwar stecke ich in vielen meiner Gestalten drin, keiner aber ist mein Selbstbildnis. Wied's choice of a parable-like, of the parable-like names for most of the characters in the novel, as well as her modernist narrative strategies, should have prevented critics from expecting a close representation of an English boarding school during the Second World War, but criticism for inaccurate representations was still voiced. Now, I'm not sure, I know which funded this event partially, so I'm not sure if I should read the last bit, but I will. Jeffrey Biffle writes in Modern German Literature that the story is that of unedifying happenings at a co-educational English secondary school with a very un-English assortment of teachers. The novel is set in, according to the education boarding school, evacuated from the bombing danger of an unnamed city and relocated in den wilden Mittelwesten des Landes. The progressive nature of the school, which adheres to the motto, tu was du willst, do whatever you want, is initially welcomed by the central character Madeleine de la Tour Madrus, a refugee from Paris with an Austrian and a French background, who hoped for real space for teaching students rather than being occupied with disciplining them constantly. Over the course of the novel, however, the disadvantages of this laissez-faire attitude become apparent. Now, her position as a German and French teacher employed in the school on a short-term contract, living at the school and without a local circle of friends, embodies the material misery and the potential isolation of the refugee existence in England during the war. Her employers are exploitative and adjust the individual teacher's salary according to their desperation for getting a job. When Hermione, the final female half of the couple running the school, finds a cheaper replacement, Madeleine is sacked. The loss of status so keenly felt by many professional refugees is summed up by the narrator when Hermione introduces Madeleine to her son. Mein Sohn Arthur, Madame Madrus, unsere neue Sprachlehrerin. Der neue Titel ertönt Madeleines sonderbare Heiterung ins Ohr. Die Comtesse de la Tour ist es nicht gewohnt, mit ihrem Mädchennamen angesprochen zu werden. Den Namen und Titel, den sie seit ungefähr 22 Jahren führt, hat sie bereits in mancherlei Zusammensetzung gehört, in dieser nicht. Sprachlehrerin. Boah. Wer auf das Gehalt angewiesen ist, muss auch den Titel mit in Kauf nehmen und die schlechten Lebensformen der Leute, in deren Dienst man sich begeben hat. The injured pride of the refugee, who had enjoyed higher status in society before immigration, is present in many anecdotes regarding German-speaking refugees in Britain. While the social historical assessment of the German-speaking refugees locates this inability to adjust largely with male refugees, and while women were said to be more adaptable, Wied's fictional work adds an interesting layer to the complexity of the problem. As an academic art historian, the character Madeleine had been looking for a university lectureship and had only accepted the less interesting and less well-paid position as a language teacher where no lectureship could be obtained. The portrayal shows that the loss of status was significant and a significant psychological factor for both men and women, although the latter, of course, were less often found among the ranks of professionals. Wied's narrative, however, also points to the complex intersection of the social status and gender. A man would not have had a married name. Madeleine is shown to have become a comtesse through marriage and have enjoyed the aristocratic name and status in France. The exile strips her, therefore, of a layer of status, but it can be read in a way that it also releases her from a layer of dependence. Madeleine Madrus, the refugee, is an independent woman who prefers to endure the conditions of her employment in the British boarding school rather than being helped to gain a university lectureship in Switzerland by two male friends. One of these friends offers her this alternative in a letter. Für mich liegt etwas Rührendes, etwas Erschütterndes in ihrer Selbstverleugnung. Aber ich erkenne zugleich auch ihre Gefahr. Sie dieser zu entziehen, möchte ich Sie bitten, eine Schweizer Einreiseerlaubnis, die ich unschwer für Sie erwirken kann, anzunehmen. Und gewiss wird sich dann auch für die Verfasserin des Monumentalwerks über die französischen Bildteppiche des Mittelalters ein Universitätslehramt finden. The rejection can be interpreted, so Madeleine rejects this, can be interpreted as emancipatory, especially since the narrative of the letter provides such a patronizing introduction. Madeleine is shown as independent of her old friends as well as her acquaintances at the school. Stefan continues in his analysis of exile writer as a whole that the exile theme did not lend itself to construction of a narrative whole. Ein geschlossenes, gestaltetes Epos, das die historische Entwicklungslinie des Exils herausgearbeitet hätte, ließ sich inmitten der unruhigen Jahre der Verbannung aber nur schwer herstellen. In fact, he criticizes Leon Feuchtwanger's Balthasar trilogy for taking on the huge task of illuminating historical developments in Germany between 1914 and 1939. Stefan's verdict, however, can be seen as a commentary on the impossibility of thematizing the period in a certain narrative style rather than just a criticism of Feuchtwanger. Eine Methode, die Stoffmasse formal zu bewältigen, findet auch Feuchtwanger nicht, Stefan writes. Stefan prefers texts by Anna Segers and Bertolt Brecht that do not attempt to create a complete meta-narrative. Statt dem formalen Chaos von Klaus Manns Der Vulkan und Leon Feuchtwangers Exil zu verfallen, erfassen sie die Wirrnisse der Zeit in moderner Form. In der modernen Form kaleidoskopisch arrangierter Einzelepisoden. Now I think the kaleidoscope is a model I would like to use in my analysis. And I would like to argue that it points to the modernity of many novels by women exile writers. The different perspectives touch like small pieces in a kaleidoscope, change their position, and form different visions of a possible whole. In Wied's Das Krähennest, this is achieved not so much by a representation of different sections of society, such as it is in Arnold Gmeyner's work, we'll discuss that later, but by the different levels of events and narratives. Now, the subtitle of Das Krähennest is Begebnisse auf verschiedenen Ebenen. These levels shift and realign, showing the streams of consciousness technique, which sets her novel apart from the exile novels that are labeled stylistically conservative. The style reflects her interest in the interrelationship of psychoanalysis and literature, which becomes apparent in Das Krähennest through her use of the uncanny and the doppelganger motif. Andrew Bennett and Nicholas Royal argue that, and I quote, literature itself could be defined as the discourse of the uncanny. It makes the familiar strange, it challenges our beliefs and assumptions about the world and the nature of reality. According to Bennett and Roy, the uncanny involves repetition, such as the idea of the double or double doppelganger. Literary representations of times of existential decision-making, such as the decision whether to leave the National Socialist German Reich, are an obvious source for this motif, as decisions sort of always to leave always include thinking about the alternative scenario that might happen if one stayed. In Das Krähennest, two characters, Madeleine and her former lover Ernest, choose different options when faced with the German occupation of France. Madeleine chooses exile in Britain, while Ernest stays in Paris and becomes a collaborator with the National Socialist occupiers. Ernest appears only mediated through others in Wied's narrative. An article entitled Lust am Verrat in Der Ausblick, which is an anti-National Socialist journal, sets off Madeleine's train of thought regarding Ernest. She recalls another article in the Nazi-friendly paper Deutsch-Französische Rundschau, which praised Ernest's choice and hailed him as a true representative of a new National Socialist France. Das ist ein longer quote. Wenn ein hoher Mensch wie Ernest unsere neue Ordnung als gerecht und erstrebenswert anerkennt, kann er sich willig, ja hingerissen bereit zeigt uns sein Frankreich, worin er tiefer verwurzelt ist als irgendeiner, nach Landschaft, Volkstum, Überlieferung und lebendig fortwirkenden Kräften, nach seiner staatlichen und persönlichen Eigenart genauer kennenzulernen, mehr, wenn er uns die geistigen und die ungeistigen Voraussetzungen enthüllt, welche die politische Haltung seiner Volksgenossen hintergründen. Wolle der Feind nun doch auch seinen Namen als Schimpf gebrauchen, damit wir ihn zum weiterhin halben Ehrennamen wandelten, als den des ersten hervorragendsten und wertvollsten Vorkämpfers für die deutsch-französische Verständigung. Now, Martin's thoughts outline Ernest's justification for collaboration with the National Socialist occupiers of his beloved France, and has argued that it was his duty to stay and gain power in order to be able to save many vor dem Konzentrationslager, vor dem Gefängnis, wirtschaftlichem Zusammenbruch, ja, vor Hinrichtung, rather than cowardly saving his own skin by going into exile. The view that the separation from one's roots would have a detrimental effect on one's physical and spiritual being, and that staying in France and collaborating is the preferred option. Dass alles ist besser als ein heimatloser Flüchtling zu sein und das entsichtlichte Leben des Exils zu führen, is portrayed as that of Ernest in Madeleine's thought processes. Madeleine recalls her response in a past conversation: man kann auch sein Vaterland verlieren, wenn man darin bleibt, und man kann es mit sich nehmen überall hin. The complexity of the narrative, however, leads to a blurring of the views as well as the positions of the different characters. Now, I've mentioned Wied's double heritage, and this influenced clearly her positioning, or the positioning of the novel, between Austrian tradition and European modernism. She seems to have been politically acceptable to the establishment during the Dollfuss regime, since she managed to have her novel Asyl zum Obdachlosen Geist published in the Wiener Zeitung in 1934. The paper at the time was loyal to the Dollfuss regime or government. Therefore, the reasons why Wied had to leave Austria may have been extremely complex. Her Jewish heritage might not have felt like the most obvious threat to her at the time, since being closely associated with right-wing Catholicism might also have been a substantial risk factor for Wied in post-Anschluss Austria. I will now come to Anna Gmeyner, and she had a completely different political background. She was also born in Vienna into a Jewish family, but 20 years after Wied. She was part of left-wing political groups in Germany, and she had moved to Berlin in the 1920s. She rose to power, she happened to be in Paris, and she never returned to Germany. Now, Kaffee und Dom was originally written in German, but it was only published in the English translation in 1941 in London. The novel starts with Nadia, a Russian-born, German-speaking refugee living in Paris, attempting to facilitate her husband's release from Dachau concentration camp. Her husband, Peter Schumacher, is an active communist, and the novel focuses more on political exiles than on those who had to leave Germany because of their Jewish background. Jewishness or racial persecution is mentioned only as marginal, really, and does not get such a central, substantial attention as in Gmeyner's earlier novel, Mania. Again, there are, however, a number of plots and subplots which diverge and converge in a complex manner. The place where the different strands of the plot and the different characters come together is the Café du Dôme, and historically this café in the center of Paris was known to be a meeting place for German intellectuals even before the First World War, and remained so after 1933, when numerous refugees arrived from neighboring Germany. And Gmeyner herself uses the term kaleidoscope in Café de Dom, in the novel Café de Dom, describing Nadia's husband as, and I quote, enjoying the kaleidoscopic life at the Dom, with its sudden and fleeting glimpses into the lives and destinies of all kinds of people. Café de Dom introduces its readers to Paris on the 14th of July, Bastille Day, and during the celebrations. And in Café de Dom, Gmeyner uses her portrayal of the celebrating crowds as a successful contrast to Nadia, the refugee's loneliness. Sabina Becker, in an article on Die literarische Moderne im Exil, Kontinuitäten und Brüche zur Stadtwahrnehmung, so views of cities, states that it's often suggested that the exile writers found it difficult to portray city life. Die Erfahrung städtischer Wahrnehmungskategorien wie Bewegung, Dynamik, Simultanität, Schnelligkeit und Fragmentarismus ästhetisch zu verarbeiten. Now Becker cites Klaus Mann's Der Vulkan as an example that contradicts this trend, and I would say that Café de Dom is another example. Movement, simultaneity, and fragmentation are very important. While the crowds move around to celebrate the liberation of Paris and of the ancien regime, I suppose the exile Nadia sits in the cafe thinking of her husband who's imprisoned in Dachau. This simultaneity opens up a spectrum of reality and unreality or alternative scenarios, which I think is part of this kaleidoscopic structure of the novel. We're given a view of the exiles with a glimpse at the destitute refugee as a party guest who, I quote, clutches a dish with salmon sandwiches and stuffs them one after another into his mouth with alarming rapidity, and, for example, with the portrayal of the exile's accommodation, the room is described with dirty yellow curtains that let in no light, and it's a hotel that more often than not rents out the rooms by the hour. The narrator also portrays an old couple at a train station, him wearing a grey suit, a quote, that has become too loose for him, and her, quote, in a shabby silk dress, and their reluctance to let go of the only thing left to them on this earth, each other. These are the sort of external universal symbols of exile. I quote again, you could find no more heart-rendering symbols of the suffering of the haunted exile. That's what Gmeyner writes herself. Again, in Café de Dom, questions are raised about the real and the unreal, about the exile's desires and hopes. I quote, here in the Dom, however, Nadia had a kind of rendezvous with someone who in reality was imprisoned in Dachau. Just as the little long-haired musician had an appointment with Toscanini and the Danish girl with her faithless lover. Now, Gmeyner herself comments on her narrative strategies, and I quote, it was all like a modern theatrical set. You saw a cross-section of houses in which people lived and died side by side, only the audience being privileged to see all the scenes at once, and the lights going on in one of the cells and going out in another. But there in the Dom, the production was rather different. Everything happened all over the place and simultaneously. This simultaneity is part of the modernity of Gmeyner's novel, refuting that view that most novels with this sort of overt political message written in exile are stylistically conservative. Now I will conclude with Gmeyner's portrayal of gender, and here she is more radical than most exile writers. She does not shy away from criticizing the left wing, And as in her novel Mania, motherhood is seen to be a subversive possibility. Peter is shown as a failed left-wing activist who states that, and I quote, children make men reactionary and women out. And at the end of the novel, Nadia rejects Peter and decides to bring up her child without him, with the help of a female friend. Bringing up a child without a father is shown as the preferred option. Quote, it belongs to us alone, it's our business, not theirs, unquote, Nadia's female friend states. And the happy ending of a conventional romantic novel where Nadia would get together with another man are rejected. Gmeyner's alternative scenarios include the possibility of physical attraction between women. She subverts the conventional feminine setting of a beauty salon into a space for mental and physical intimacy between Nadia and her female friend. While assessing their different lives and giving each other advice about their relationships with men, the possibility of physical attraction between women is also present. I quote, it gave Nadia pleasure to gaze upon the beauty of Irene's tall, faultless body as she strode to the door. And although Irene explicitly states that she has no lesbian tendency, albeit with regret, the possibility of an alternative to heterosexual relationships is clearly open in this narrative. Now, I hope I've shown that both in style and content, there are radical modern elements to these two novels by women exile writers, and this might point towards a continuity with the earlier writings by Jewish women and also with post-war women's writing. Jane Marcus, in an essay, in a volume on gender and exile, writes that it is her task to understand, and I quote, the ethics of the women's writers' elsewhereness, for elsewhere is not nowhere. It is a political place where the displaced are always seen and see themselves in relationship to the place. So interesting, our discussion across multiculturalism and other aspects. Writers like Anna Gmeyner and Martina Wied can be positioned in a variety of elsewherenesses as exiles because of their Jewish background and as women writers. They continued the modern project, and I think it's our duty to uncover their work. Thank you very much.